Today, we are going to study about the strategies for social science. As you are aware, there are a number of strategies in social science which we may use for teaching and learning, right? When we learn together, there are some things which come naturally in the field of social science, especially when you are debating critical issues, such as problem solving and critical pedagogy. Today, we are going to discuss in detail how the strategy of problem solving and critical pedagogy can be used in teaching learning of social sciences, with this hope that all of you are going to use this in your teaching learning classrooms in future. So let's begin with understanding the nuances of problem solving and critical pedagogy. Problem solving is an instructional strategy which is used to develop conceptual understanding and the ability to transfer and apply those understandings to new situations. That means not only do you understand the concept, you also learn how to apply that concept in your daily life or to a new situation. Only then can you consider that you've used this successfully as an instructional strategy, and students have also learned the absolute techniques of problem solving. When students are taught through this method, they develop opportunities to think rationally and develop thinking skills. It is extremely important as students of social science or in other subjects as well to know how to think about things in a different way, think rationally, look at the pros and cons, look at the strengths and weaknesses. You're able to differentiate between fact and propaganda. You look at a thing as a whole and are able to divide it into parts. So a lot of thinking goes into problem solving, because as the name suggests, the name is about problem solving. Now, thinking is the basic skill required in problem solving, by which students make sense out of experiences. What, why, how of an experience? You think it out rationally. Both thinking skills and problem solving can be taught to students by providing problem solving situations and opportunities to solve these problems. What does it mean? How do you provide problem solving opportunities? You provide problem solving opportunities by involving them in projects, involving them in situations which require solutions, right? And enabling them to think, enabling them to make decisions. And it's very important that students do not have any fear of going wrong. Because if you have a fear of going wrong, you cannot think creatively, and your thinking process itself absolutely doesn't function the way it should, thinking of all the different dimensions. Therefore, it has to be an absolutely fearless environment where the child is able to think rationally, different pros and cons, and he is able to come to the solution of a given problem. This can be done in groups, this can be done individually, or as a collaborative learning exercise. Now, going further, now what are the different steps of problem solving? It is very, very important for us to know what are the steps of problem solving. First and foremost, as the name suggests, problem solving. That means first you need to know what is the problem. So identifying the problem, identification of the problem is the first step. First, the teacher and the students have to find out what exactly is the problem. See, you're going to solve the problem once you know what the problem is. So identification of the problem is the first step. Then they have to understand, they means both the teacher and the students alike, and define the problem. That means you define the problem in clear, unambiguous language so that it is understood by all. The problems must be related to students' existing knowledge and must use familiar real life situations. Now, if you have a problem, for example, there may be a problem of disposal of waste. So this is a problem which is related to real life, and accordingly students may be be made to sit together and let them discuss what are the right mechanisms for the disposal of waste. What are the different dynamics? How do we differentiate between biodegradable, non-biodegradable waste, so on and so forth? So it has to be related to real life situations or the current problem. For example, when you talk of social science also relates to a different aspects. For example, you have democracy, you have citizenship. Now, to inculcate citizenship in students, okay, what are the different strategies which can be used? And you can give them different situations in which they are exposed to. And from these different situations, they tell you that, okay, as an effective citizen, what will I be able to do in this particular situation? Yeah, there are a number of examples which you can give them to problem solve, right? So, but relate them so that they are able to find solutions which are close to their heart and they understand that, yes, I'm going to deal with them in my real life. Okay, and even simple things like traffic rules are to be done in ways such that, for example, the problem of people breaking traffic rules, how do we solve it? Let them sit together and try to brainstorm with reference to how do I arrive to a solution wherein I inculcate the habit of following traffic rules in the citizens of the country, right? Now, after you have identified the problem comes the second step. How do I design the method of problem solving? That means the problem is there. I have identified the problem. I have clearly defined the problem. The problem has been understood by the students. Now they have to design the process of solving the problem. Once they decide on the method of solving, they have to explain as to why they have selected that particular strategy. You know, you, for example, if you say that I'm going to solve the problem through these steps, okay? If you are talking of these steps, you need to know how would you be looking at those steps, how would you be executing those steps, and why have you chosen to use these steps to solve this given problem? So systematic planning and explaining of each step will help students in developing problem-solving process skills. See, problem-solving is a process, right? It's not that there is a problem and you get a given solution. No. You brainstorm, you sit together, you think about it laterally, creatively, and then you arrive at a solution of a given problem. So, this is how, by systematically planning and thinking of each and every step which would be required to solve a given problem, they learn the way of solving the problem. Now, the third step. Well, you have identified the problem. You have also thought about the strategy, how you are going to solve a given problem. Now, the third is executing the plan. How do you execute? Executing or implementing the plan? How are you going to implement the problem-solving method which you decided upon? So, after designing the method of solving the problem, you need to execute it, right? So, this requires students to collect, organize, and analyze data to arrive at solutions. For example, if you really want the citizens to follow the traffic rules, you have to see what are the kind of violations. You will have to look at the violations in the past so many months. You will have to analyze the data. You will have to see whether the violations are of jumping the red light, whether the violations are of speeding, so on and so forth. Organize the entire data, analyze the data. Only then you would be able to implement whatever the plan of action you have to prevent these kind of violations and also prevent accidents on the road, right? Now, the fourth step is evaluating these solutions, which is also extremely important. This is the last step in problem solving. In this step, students need to check for all the evidences and data that support the problem solution. Wherever possible, students should be encouraged to apply the solution to a new and similar situation, which would give ideas about the correctness and validity of the solution. For example, if you say that, okay, finding the drivers, okay, for violations, traffic violations, is one of the solutions. So you will have to look at different case studies which have been undertaken. That has finding the drivers really resulted in a positive outcome with reference to reducing the number of traffic violations. So that is very, very important that you find a correlation to evaluate the solution to a given problem. So this also gives you a perspective with reference to future, with reference to the strategies which you may use for problem solving. So evaluation is also extremely important after you have executed the plan for problem solving. Now, by following the problem solving method, it is possible to develop abilities in learners such as analytical thinking, because you are analyzing data, you are looking at the trends, critical thinking, thinking out of the box, thinking about the pros and cons, thinking about the strengths and weaknesses. So you are looking at things from different perspectives and relating cause and effect. It is very, very important to relate the cause to the effect when you're trying to find a problem to a solution. Then rationalizing and reasoning. This is also very important that you have given reasons that fine, this is the solution which I found and through this solution, this is the outcome. Okay, by applying this particular problem solving method. Now giving judgment along with the development of social values. Now once you have executed, you've tried to find a social, a solution to a social problem, you also see what are the kind of social values which may develop in learners. Problem solving also leads to the development of different kinds of values, you know. Values related to team spirit, values related to democracy, values related to cooperative learning, honest dealings, so on and so forth, right? And teacher is required to guide. The role of the teacher is that of a facilitator here. The teacher is required to guide students in the process of solving the problem, right? You don't provide solutions. It's very, very important. You are a facilitator who helps them to identify the problem. You are a facilitator who helps them to clearly demarcate the problem. Then you enable them or, you know, support them in strategizing how to form the solution to the problem. And finally, you will also, if they need help, let them evaluate how far the problem has been solved through the strategies which the students have used to solve a given problem. So the final step of evaluation also is very, very important. But one word of caution, you are not supposed to be giving them cues or directions such that instead of problem solving, it just becomes a teacher-centered activity where the students are followers and the teacher is the leader. No. The role of the teacher here, because you want to develop the thinking skills, the analytical skills of the learners, right? The reasoning. They need to rationalize what they are doing. So it's extremely important in social sciences that the teacher plays the role of the facilitator. Now moving further, we know that teachers are the most important agents of socialization, right? So at all stages of education, we need to understand that the emphasis is on shared meanings. Shared meanings means the meaning of a particular experience which I, together with my students, make or understand together. Context and cultures which the students bring with them in a classroom context is very, very important to understand. Every child comes from a different culture and brings with him or her that culture inside the classroom. So you have to understand the context and cultures. Any knowledge building or sharing has to be done collaboratively. It is very, very important, you know, that it is a collaborative endeavor so that problem solving becomes experience sharing also, and it becomes a learning experience where we all learn from each other collaboratively. And learners need to be instilled with the belief that education is a process for their emancipation or their freedom, right? They should see it as a process which helps them in emancipation. So it's extremely important that through this problem solving method, you socialize the learners in the process of collaborative learning. You socialize the learners to understand each other. You also socialize them into looking at that how one problem, you know, may be perceived by all the learners differently. All of them will collate their ideas and arrive at a particular solution to a given problem, right? So this process enables them to critically think, enables them to rationalize, enables them to analyze a given solution to provide the solution to a given problem. Right. Now, moving further, let's come to critical pedagogy now. As you are aware, it has two words, critical and pedagogy. Critical pedagogy, basically as a concept, is a pedagogical tool through which the teacher and the student negotiate the curriculum collectively in a way that involves questioning the existing social, economic, political policies and practices around us, reflecting on them, and through our collective efforts, acting to make a difference to the world we inhabit, right? So what exactly do we understand by that? That means through critical pedagogy, there is a classroom teaching learning situation wherein I am able to brainstorm with the students on different issues, issues which are surrounding us. They may be social in nature, they may be economic in nature, they may be political in nature, because education essentially is also political in nature, right? And after reflecting on them, then you, through collective efforts, try to find that how do we transform this world in which we live? What kind of difference do we foresee? What difference can we make to a world such that it becomes more equal, more just, more democratic, more humane, and more enlightened? And the chief champions for this entire, it's a movement or ideology or a method of critical pedagogy, were Paulo Freire, Henry Giroux, Peter MacLaren, Ira Shore, to name a few. These are the people who have been championing the cause of critical pedagogy. However, if we see very less number of teachers really practicing critical pedagogy in the classroom, wherein they allow their students to question practices, they allow their students to, you know, question the existing status quo, they allow their students or give them the freedom to reflect upon the socio-economic fabric of the country, that means you're talking of equality, you're talking of freedom, you're talking of justice, right? So critical pedagogy is something wherein you question, you reflect, and you act on a given situation, right? Such because emancipation or transforming the reality is the ultimate aim of critical pedagogy. Let's go a little further. How do we achieve it? This can, however, remember, never be achieved till we continue with our present model of teaching. In most of the classroom, what do you find is, most of the classrooms, information being stuffed in the minds of students without drawing any connections with their lives or realities, and thus it becomes meaningless. Most of the time you find students questioning, why am I learning what I'm learning? What is the use of what I'm learning? Where will I apply this learning? So therefore, if the student doesn't find what you're teaching meaningful, then naturally the student wouldn't be interested in what is being deliberated upon in the classroom. In the words of Paulo Freire, this is the banking model of education where you keep stuffing information which the student just finds useless, right? The classroom is teacher-centered and authoritarian. What do you mean by teacher-centered and authoritarian? That means you have in most of the cases, you have dialogue which is considered to be a classroom which is not authoritarian, but where you do not have dialogue and you have monologic teaching, right? The discourse which is practiced is monologic. That means the teacher is speaking and the students are listening. And the students have no chance to raise questions on the conflicts which bother them. That is a classroom which is teacher-centered and authoritarian. That means the teacher does not give you the freedom to question, does not give you the freedom to raise your voice, does not give the freedom to have a different point of view, to have an alternate point of view. Right? So whenever teaching and learning is monologic in nature, you have a teacher-centered and authoritarian climate in the classroom. So it is extremely important when you're talking of critical pedagogy, the hallmark of critical pedagogy is dialogic. The classroom has to be an environment where dialogue is fostered. Dialogue means that it is a two-way communication from the teacher to the taught and from the taught to the teacher. It is very important that you involve the students in their teaching learning which is going on in the classroom. At present, what we find is a system which encourages rote memorization of facts and fails miserably in putting the students on the path of critical thinking. When you think that, okay, just memorize facts and just reproduce them in the answer sheets when the examination comes, there is no question of any critical thinking there. Where the questions also are of the nature that you are continuously asking what or is factual, and there is no application of critical thinking, you don't have questions which stimulate the thinking of the learners, then you can just imagine what kind of thinking skills we would be developing in our learners, right? The students who belong to the marginalized groups, socially marginalized, economically marginalized, need to be empowered through the practice of critical pedagogy. And you know, when you're talking of need to be empowered, it's very, very important to us to understand that empowerment also begins by giving their voices a chance to be heard. Students need to be heard, irrespective of their backgrounds, irrespective of their backgrounds based on gender, based on caste, based on religion, based on race, based on region. Every learner who's there in my classroom needs to be heard, such that they're able to understand, you know, the reasons for their conflicts and struggles. And through education, they achieve social mobility. I'm talking especially with reference to the marginalized groups. Why? Because we are talking of, through critical pedagogy, we are talking of transformation of this social reality which is there. You remember at the beginning when we talked of the aim of critical pedagogy, why exactly do we indulge in, critical pedagogy is to make the world more just, more free, more empathetic, more humane, more democratic. So when this is the aim, it is very, very important that every voice is heard in the classroom. Now, the following are a few indicators or parameters which serve as a focal point to the practice of critical pedagogy in the classroom. Right? That means, how do I know that this classroom has critical pedagogy being practiced. Let us look at these indicators or parameters. First and foremost, the extent to which dialogue is fostered in a classroom. That means how many times in different ways do you see dialogue being fostered, encouraged, children being motivated to enter into dialogue with each other, children being motivated to enter into dialogue with the teacher. This engagement is very, very important, this dialogic teaching learning, right? This is one indicator. The second is the engagement in finding answers to queries raised by students collectively. When students raise collectively, it's very, very important for the teacher not to shove the query under the carpet. You know, every question which is raised by the student is a question worthy of finding an answer or giving an answer. It is very, very important that you engage with learners, right? You may engage with learners collectively, but listen to their queries, let them raise questions. Because whenever a student raises a question, there is a thinking which goes behind that question. So it's very, very important that you allow them to question, right? Allow them to question means that you give them the environment such that they are not hesitant, they don't feel shy, they don't feel fearful when they raise questions. So questions have to be tackled with humility such that the student feels empowered, the student feels confident in asking those questions. Now the third very, very important parameter is inclusion of daily life experiences of students in the classroom discourse. It's very, very important in social science especially to bring in the social realities which are surrounding us. Let us discuss them threadbare. Let us look at the social reality from different perspectives such that we are able to understand how to create a healthy, lively democracy where every voice is heard, right? The interaction of the student and the teacher as equals, breaking the barrier hierarchy is very important. Whenever you say, oh, I am the teacher and you are the learner, there is a hierarchy which plays up. So it's very, very important that you understand that this interaction is between each other. It is not interaction, as Paulo Freire says, from A to B, but it is an interaction of A with B. Understanding that education is essentially political in nature, it's very, very important. And therefore, when you talk that it is essentially political in nature, you need to understand that the social and economic and political realities need to be a part of the classroom discourse. Then students and teachers both have to learn and teach collaboratively, right? It has to be a collaborative teaching learning environment. And then meaningful engagement with the aim to transform social reality for the better, right? If there are crime against women, what do we do such that these crimes go down? If you feel that there's discrimination on the basis of caste, what do we do such that discrimination doesn't happen? So there has to be meaningful engagement such that we transform social reality for the better, making it a more just and humane world to live in. Then inclusion of social justice is a recurring theme in teaching learning. It is important that social justice remains a very, very important thread when you're talking of any kind of deliberations in a with reference to democracy, with reference to governance, with reference to citizenship, so on and so forth. The in critical pedagogy, the very important premise on which it is based is social justice. So inclusion of social justice as a recurring theme is very, very important. And lastly, when you talk of critical pedagogy in the classroom, ensuring that the classroom is a democratic pedagogical space, right? A democratic pedagogical space means everybody can question, everybody can have a different opinion, and opinions are respected, right? Opinions are not looked at with remorse, opinions are not, you know, looked at as or classified as good opinions or bad opinions. We have a space which is diverse. We have a space where multiculturalism is respected, and it is a lively space where ideas are debated collectively, right? So the creation of a climate for the practice of critical pedagogy would include ensuring that there is dialogical teaching in the classroom, and dialogic teaching is best understood by looking at the principles put forward by Robin Alexander. According to Robin Alexander, dialogic teaching includes the following five principles. Collective, where the teachers and children address learning tasks together, whether as a group or as a class, together we are addressing it. Reciprocal, teachers and children listen to each other, share ideas, and consider alternative viewpoints, right? You're listening to each other and you're sharing alternative viewpoints. Supportive, children articulate their ideas freely without fear of embarrassment over wrong answers, and they help each other to reach common understanding. Cumulative, teachers and children build on their own and each other's knowledge and experiences. Okay? And then purposeful, teachers plan and facilitate dialogic teaching with particular educational goals in view. Therefore, the prerequisite to the practice of critical pedagogy would be to educate teachers about this liberatory practice. With this, we come to the end of problem solving as critical pedagogy as strategies for social science. I wish you all the very best, such that each one of you uses these two strategies in the social science classroom and understand the social realities and are able to transform it for the better. Thank you very much. I hope you've understood both the concepts well.